Can you put that over here?
Sure.
Okay.
Is airplane mode fine?
How did this August group come together the first time? How did you all get, did somebody shove you together or do you?
Actually, DreamWorks found the DreamWorks development team went to the Bologna Book Fair and discovered the book, which is written by Cressida, How to Train Your Dragon.
And it was 10 years ago now. I mean, yeah, 2004, 10 years ago.
And then I think they brought the book to DreamWorks and I got to read it. And I told Jeffrey Katzenberg, I said, that's for me. I said, that's the movie I want to do. That feels like my sensibility. And
what was it that drew you to it?
I don't know. I didn't know Cressida at the time, but I really liked the characters, and there was just something about it that felt different. And I like the storytelling, but like I said, more than anything, I like the characters. I identified with the Hiccup character, and
the book was autobiographical in origin, and I think sometimes that is why people have connected with it. It's very much about my relationship with my father. Stoic the Last is my father. And so I think that everybody sort of brings, I feel that Dean, maybe, you know, you bring your own relationship with your father to that. Everybody brings that. I think that personal bit of it, it sort of resonates with people.
Right.
That's what
but I think. But I think it's all the interrelationships. It's Hiccup's relationship with Stoic, Hiccup's relationship with Toothless, the relationship between the different kids. I don't know, what do you think, Dean?
Yeah,
kind of draws you the material?
I think any character who is determined to fit in but ill-equipped to succeed is kind of a character that's immediately rootable and sympathetic. So I think that's that drew a lot of people into it because they can see themselves in that struggle.
So how did you see yourself in that struggle, Cressida? I mean, was that an obvious leap to dragons?
Yes, that's a very long story, which is that although I grew up in London, I spent half of my dad was a businessman, but he was also a great environmentalist. He was chairman of Kew Gardens, chairman of the RSPB. And so every summer, he would take us to this uninhabited island off the west coast of Scotland, and we'd be dropped off there by a local fisherman and picked up again 2 weeks later. And so the Isle of Burke is a real place. This was an island so small that when you stood on the top of it, you could see sea all around you. And, you know, we had to fish to kind of, you know, to get food to eat. There was no houses, no electricity. It was sort of almost like Robinson Crusoe type thing. And by the time we were nine, my dad had a house built on the island and we spent the whole summer there. And this was the place the Vikings first came to when they invaded Britain.
So you had completely different lives. You were living this
schizophrenic life in London, very urban. And then the whole summer, by the time I was nine, it was 5 weeks on an island off the west coast of Scotland, where the Vikings first came when they invaded Great Britain. We were playing in little ruined houses where real Vikings would have lived, and the Vikings, of course, that believed that dragons really did exist. They thought they were real creatures. And if you live somewhere like that, you can see why. If you live on the sea, you know, because real monsters do live in the sea.
So have you guys visited this Burke? Is it called Burke or is it called something
else? No, I think you guys, you took a team to Scandinavia because, of course, you know, the books were inspired by Viking Scotland. But if you're making a movie about Vikings, you know, you sent a team to Scandinavia, I think?
Well, we went to Norway. It's a sort of a kind of a photo safari research trip for movie 2. And that was sort of more the inspiration for movie 2. But I think Burke also, it was more of a fantasy place. I mean, a place we tried to make it that way, I think. I mean,
sort of a fictitious island in the North Sea somewhere.
Well, the Vikings got everywhere. That's the thing. Anywhere in the North Sea.
So how did you dive into it? How did you dive into it?
I came into it rather late, actually. Myself and Chris Sanders joined the first How to Train Your Dragon with about 15 months out from production. It had a fixed release date, but they were still searching for a take on the story that would be broad enough to kind of support like a bigger fantasy adventure. And so we just brought some new elements to it and kind of kept the spirit of Cressida's books and all the characters, you know.
So you're being a team player at that point?
It was my first experience at DreamWorks, actually. So the assignment was to just sort of broaden, in a way, sort of broaden the audience with a little bit more of an action adventure fantasy take on the world and the material, using all of the great things that Cressida had come up with. Like, I think one of the genius things that she did with her book series is that there isn't just one type of dragon. You know, there are all of these different dragons, and they all have different personalities and attributes and abilities. And it makes for a really rich world, you know, so every island can have a new tribe and new types of dragons, and it goes on and on and on. It kind of writes itself in a way.
So was this a nerve-wracking point for you, Bonnie, at that point? Were you...
You mean just in terms...
As you were bringing in new help to try to, you know, finish the movie and
well,
get it...
Well, you know, I have to say I knew that there was a good movie to be made there somewhere. And I think the great thing that, at least for the first movie, that Dean and Chris brought to it was really this storytelling that sort of grew beyond this, you know, like personal story of Cressida, a.k.a. Hiccup, and their adventures, or so to speak. So I thought, you know, very much supported what Chris and Dean were trying to do. And then, you know, we came upon, you know, it's kind of slightly surprising success and becoming beloved, and the idea that we would do a second film.
It was one of the leggiest animated films in a long time when it came out.
I definitely think, you know, of all the films that I've been involved in, I feel like this one has this... kind of unusual journey of discovery by people. Like even 4 years later, people are really still discovering movie one, which is kind of interesting. It wasn't just in the moment and then it was done. People really like it, see it multiple times, and now that they know that there's a second film, they're going back and watching it again, which is kind of a testament to Dean and the first movie team of really bringing this real
it's
world
a
to life.
It's a touching movie. I mean, both movies are very touching, they're genuinely emotionally moving, and that is quite rare to really move people. Like that. That's what I think about both movies. You know, especially in an animation. You know, to make people cry in an animation. I mean, that's a big thing. I think I think the movie genuinely moves people, not only to be really excited. I mean, it's a very exciting movie, obviously. You know, the flying scenes are extraordinary. You really do feel like you're actually flying. I mean, I think it's the closest thing to actually flying, particularly if you sit in 3D. I mean, it really are. But it's moving, and that's rare. And people love to be moved.
Yeah.
They love that.
So when you guys look at doing a second movie, there are multiple books, right?
Well, there's going to be 12 books.
There'll be 12 books total.
Yeah.
Maybe there'll be 12 movies. But going into the second movie, is it, okay, let's look at the other books and try to find the story, or is it we need to do something that is similar but a little different? What's the thinking going into the second film?
It's a... When I was asked to consider ideas for the sequel, I have this sort of allergy to sequels a lot of the time, because it feels like it just retreads over familiar material and dresses it up in a different way, and it feels a bit like a cash grab oftentimes. And so I wanted it to feel necessary, so I'd pitched back the idea of it being a trilogy, and this would be the second act of a larger three-act story, but one that tracks Hiccup's coming of age to become a wise Viking chief, but ends where Cressida's books will end, with some explanation as to what happened to the dragons and why they are no more, because it has kind of a powerful quality to it. Mm-hmm. So although the narratives have diverged, you know, Toothless in the books is a much smaller dragon, you know, and Hiccup can speak to the dragons, there are enough differences in the narrative that the movies have kind of become their own riff on Cressida's world. Mm. So there's nothing specifically related to the books beyond, you know, the world that was created. And so they take on their own narrative, but their ideas, and in particular that one, you know, the sort of grand ambition to sort of have the world be reset to the one we know from the history books, but for a period of time, dragons roam the earth, and I think that's really compelling.
Mm. I just had a conversation, oddly enough, with Mr. Katzenberg, who was talking already about the third movie and maybe the fourth movie. He seems to think that your ideas for the third movie are so voluminous that they may require an hour,
I only just
3
heard
hours
this.
Instead of 1 hour.
I heard about this over dinner last night. We'll have to have a discussion.
I think more importantly, though, that I think the real charge was to do a second film that really was satisfying, that had its own story. And I think, really, I have to say, our focus has been on that. I mean, you know, and I feel, you know, right now moving into this, you know, very proud that that's, I feel like it, as far as the filmmaking team, we've achieved that, to make something that audience can go and, I mean, Cressida is looking on it from just one step removed, and is that true? I mean, yeah. That's, yeah, I think that was our ambition.
I mean, it feels meant. Adini's absolutely right. There's nothing more depressing when there's a movie that you love and then they bring out something that hasn't been thought through or just doesn't feel like it was meant, and this feels totally meant, and people were coming out saying how they liked it even more than the first movie, which is, you know, and that's a rare thing.
I think that's the challenge, you know, I started to realize the challenge of sequels is that, especially when something has a place, which, you know, where people like the first movie and this and that, I mean, wow, not only do we feel pressure from ourselves to make it as good a movie as we could, but you know, this rising, you know, sort of interest by the fans of the movie, and when think, you know, boy, there's an expectation there, and we have to do our best not only to please ourselves as filmmakers, but to kind of, you know, give the audience something that they will enjoy and be satisfied about, and all in one film. It was challenging in that way, I think.
A very different experience now, being, because when the first one came out, it was kind of an unknown thing to some degree. It was, you're kind of underdogs. Now you're kind of overdogs. Mm-hmm. There are a lot of expectations and all that. Is it feel different, or is it just a different pressure at the end that you have to?
Oh, it is. It's completely different because you have people that are very carefully watching what we're doing, and any bit of material that kind of finds its way out there is being judged rather harshly or enthusiastically. But at every turn, there, you know, we get the sense that the fandom out there doesn't want us to mess it up. And but the one thing that's nice with the second film is that we start 5 years later. Mm-hmm. So instead of kind of rehashing Hiccup's problem of trying to fit in and earn the admiration of his father or the acceptance of his community or the affection of the girl that he has a crush on, Astrid, that's all solved, you know, so we don't have to graft on an artificial problem. By meeting him 5 years later, he's now a young adult, kind of he's on the cusp of adulthood, looking back with longing at his youth and the freedom he had, and what lays ahead for him is this sort of daunting future of stepping into his father's shoes, and he doesn't feel like he's really cut of that cloth. So it's a journey of self-discovery as he kind of finds his way out there further and further into the world, and eventually comes face to face with the other half of his soul, which is represented by Valka.
Are you a fanboy?
Yeah, of course I am. Yeah,
I mean, not just of this. I mean, in general, did you come to this into animation as a great fan of animation, history, and all that?
Well, I was a big comic book fan growing up. I wanted to be a comic book artist, and animation actually turned out to be everything I love about comic books, but living and breathing, and with a much broader reach. So it has, I think, for me, it's magical, because in animation you can do just about anything. You know, if we can dream it up, we can create it. And the technology is such now that there are no restrictions anymore. It's just a matter of time. And I think it's really impressive to see the second film, even versus the first one. You can see that the look of it and the sophistication of the animation and the nuance has leapt in these 4 years.
But it's the first time, I think, that anybody in animation has aged up the whole cast of characters. I can't think of any, and it's almost like they do feel so real. You can tell such a subtle story through, you know, the kind of characters that you've made. You know, they feel like real human beings, and I think that enables you to tell this really rich emotional story, again, which is to do with moving people.
I think the highest compliment, actually, of people that have seen the film too, is that they forget that they're watching animation. That they're watching a film and they're involved in the story and Hiccup's story and this story that Dean created and is telling. And again, to me, that's the highest compliment, that you just, that, you know, to me, if there's any technology or anything that you are paying attention to, then you kind of haven't done your job. Mm-hmm. That needs to be invisible. So if you're looking at the cinematography or you're looking at then that's the problem. You have to feel it. And I think, I love when we get that kind of feedback and they're starting to sort of trickle in, that people just, they just think they're just watching a film, which I just think that's fantastic.
And so in this short, relatively short window, I mean, how much has technology evolved? Is it that much better? Is it easier, or does it ever get easier?
It evolves by the moment. I mean, that's kind of what's pretty amazing about technology. As quickly as you get a new phone, smartphone, that's as quickly as things change. Do you know what I'm saying? And at some point, you have to sort of, you know, pick a style and pick a, you know, and you know, try to kind of stick to that part and let and just try to make your film.
Are you chasing that, or are you considering it, or?
Well, specifically on this movie, we're the first film at DreamWorks to have taken advantage of many years of development of a whole suite of animation tools. It's called Apollo, and it covers the animation process all the way through to the lighting process. The whole idea of it is to make everything real time so that the artists don't have to wait for renders, so they can really finesse and tweak. And the way in which they work now, where it used to be spreadsheets and pull down menus and numeric entry, it's all it's all sort of they're working with their hands again.
Artist friendly.
They have a stylus and they have a tablet. They manipulate the characters as you would like a stop motion animator would work with a puppet. And so it's very intuitive, and it allows the creativity to be translated into the character and the performance immediately, you know, without having to go through several laborious steps in the process.
I'm guessing you're not old enough. You're not old enough to have done 2D animation, are you?
I have. That's how I started. Yeah.
Did you actually have a pencil in your hand at some point?
I worked on Mulan. I worked on Lilo and Stitch was the first project that I wrote and directed along with Chris Sanders. So I come from that traditional animation approach, and it is very handy actually to have it because it teaches you to really pay attention to the silhouette of characters and the composition of things, and it's a nice discipline. Actually.
So is the transition less now conceptually? I mean, is the technology catching up to the point where it feels more, the experience of doing it is more like when you were more hands-on?
It is a little bit, it's almost returned to, it's not like they're working with pencil and paper, but that intuitive sense of I see something in my head and I'm going to create it has returned to the animators. Because now they work with this technology in a way that it's very sophisticated, but it's presented in a really user-friendly way for them. They can spend more time.
It's a sophisticated paintbrush, I think. I don't want to take anything away from the artist, because to me it's just a tool in the toolbox. And I think, you know, there's could be all the great tools in the world, but you're only as good as the artist that's using them. And really we have an amazing, amazing team. I mean, Dean and I are standing, you know, here before there are tons of 400 plus artists standing behind us that really did a huge amount of work and passion. And it was a labor of love. I mean, they spent a lot of time in trying to, you know, the conversation that Dean and I had 4 years ago about what the movie would be is only made better by all these unbelievable artists that touched the movie along the way. Dean and I are amazed at the end result being greater than our expectation.
And 4 years is a really long time to take for a sequel, particularly of a phenomenally successful first film. And that's the other thing. That is a brave, you know, that's the right thing to do, to make the best movie you can, even if it takes 4 years. And I think that really shows. I mean, I think people are really going to appreciate that.
So was four years a long time for you guys? Or did it
seem like... I
think
it was just shy of four, but...
Yeah, I mean, it does take about 3 to 4 years to make an animated movie. Even back in the traditional hand-drawn days, it always took that amount of time. But I think in this case, versus the first film was kind of a rush to the finish. We used everything that had been created, but we had to, you know, rework the story and kind of make everything and in the 11th hour. And on this film, you know, we were able to really craft it from the beginning, and we didn't have any major setbacks. So just about everything that we created is up on screen with very few shots that have been taken out of the film.
So is there anything you have to say no to, Bonnie? You have to go like, that's going to cross too much, that's too crazy,
I think the interesting thing is, I mean, listen, we had some parameters that we had to work within, and I think that's what movie making is about. If you had all the resources in the world and all the time in the world, anybody could do it, but I think that's sort of the craft of filmmaking. You get a certain amount of resources, whether that be a release date or money or how many animators you can have or whatever that might be, and then you try to craft the best film that you possibly can. And I think Dean and our team did an amazing job of working within those resources. So I think that's the craft of making a movie. I mean, it's, you know.
So would it be a much different movie if you had unlimited resources and another 6 months?
Yeah, you know, in a way it might be gratuitous. I think the restrictions are actually really helpful. We had enough money to make an 88-minute movie, but we managed to make a 92.5-minute movie. You know, this is not including credits. So that's just a testament to a motivated crew.
Yeah.
Because we're talking about over $1 million a minute in animation, so you can't run wild, because you will exceed the budget. But we actually managed to make the film we all intended to make and come in on budget and mm-hmm. you know, be responsible as well, which is really good because it allows us to then thrive and continue.
Yeah.
You know, if you have a runaway budget and, yeah. and the film for whatever reason doesn't do well, mm-hmm. everybody hurts, you know, the whole studio hurts. And so I think it's nice to be able to have great ambitions mm-hmm. and then set out with whatever resources you have and figure it out.
Well, I've had the conversation with animators a number of times about how with an animated film, you work and work and work and work for years, and then all of a sudden, it all starts to come together in that last 6 months.
Yeah.
And you don't really know what you have until that last 6 months, and all of a sudden, it's becoming a film in front of your eyes. Is that fair in this case, or did you...
I think in this case, we had an idea of the movie we were making for a long time, but it did gain focus, and there were a lot of great ideas that came in the last 6 months mm-hmm. that made it even better. But it's not like we were trying to figure out what the movie was about for the longest time. And I have been on productions that were like that, and it can be pretty frustrating. So we were pretty sure of the movie we were making.
But
we just weren't sure how to...
That's a testament to you, Dean. I think Dean had an idea of the movie he wanted to make, and I think he really did an amazing job of communicating that, especially to the core team of our creative core team. And those guys, men and women, did a great job of like communicating that. I think that's a really important, whether you're doing live action or animation, or what kind of film, when the director has a vision and knows what that is and communicates that to the crew, the artists, whatever. I mean, we did our best to try to see that through. And then yes, we made some changes, but I think that's the advantage of animation. Mm-hmm. You're able to edit your film before you actually shoot it, which, you know, before you actually animate it. So we did see some things, and some things, you know, from the script made some changes, but in a good way. And we, like I say, we feel good about the end result.
So you all be nervous on opening day, or is it, do you feel
tonight?
Like you've already done the
tonight.
Work?
Tonight.
Tonight's the opening night.
Tonight's our first
This is our world
screening.
Premiere.
Yeah.
It's here.
The film
yes,
festival.
Yes.
But is that different than, say, opening day in America, or
well, of
emotionally?
Course, yeah.
Or?
Because this is the most prestigious film festival in the world.
And it's such an international market, too. I mean, the yeah. international market is playing such a bigger role now in the success of films, and I feel like the whole world is here. I mean, the people at this film festival represent the international market, and we feel like if tonight's screening goes well, we hope that that's a good indicator of how the film will be, you know, viewed and accepted all over the place.
So you watch the film with the audience?
Absolutely.
Yes.
It's the first time a real audience has seen the finished movie.
And how long will it be before you know you've got them in your clutches? Is there a moment?
Well, I think pretty soon.
I think
a little bit more distance than you guys. I was
forewarned that they're a tough audience.
Yeah.
they don't laugh. You know, they don't show whether or not they're engaged.
Mm-hmm.
So you either get booed or applauded.